من فلوريدا، مساء الخير إلى جميع المشاهدين في لبنان والعالم. كوبية أمريكية ويا للتناقض، من والد ضابط أمن للرئيس الكوبي باتيستا ووالدة معلمة مدرسة، ولدت في هافانا كوبا لتهاجر العائلة وهي دون السنتين من العمر. التقت بإميليو أستفان اللبناني الأصل صاحب فريق ميامي ساوند ماشين الموسيقي ليبدأ معا رحلة العمر التي ستودي بهما إلى أعلى مراتب بورصات الأغاني العالمية. لقبت بملكة البوب اللاتيني، البلايين استمعوا إليها والملايين شاهدوا استعراضاتها الجميلة. تكتب، تلحن، تنتج، تنادي بحقوق أبناء أمريكا اللاتينية، تعمل للقضايا الإنسانية. عائلتها هي مصدر فخرها، سيدة أعمال من الطراز الأول. شملت اهتماماتها العقارات، الفنادق، الإنتاج الموسيقي، السينمائي والتلفزيوني. الليلة أحاور من ميامي غلوريا استيفان، والبداية مع هذا التقرير. Laura Estefan, good evening and thank you for being with us tonight. It's a pleasure to have you among us in this series of interviews. First of all, the question that comes first into my mind, did you set out to be famous?
Actually, no. And on the last album that I did in English, there's a song called Famous that I wrote, and it's kind of how I've looked at this whole world of fame. I loved music. I'm singing since I'm 2 years old. When I started speaking, I started singing. But I was very shy. I was not the type of person that likes to be the center of attention. And my mother would have me sing for her friends and my grandmother, and I was very embarrassed, and I would play the guitar and look at the floor, and when they would start crying, I would say, you know, why do you make me sing if you're going to cry? They say, no, that's a good thing. It means you moved us. But I never, ever imagined this life. It happened by coincidence because I met Emilio and because I love music and it became my hobby and I slowly got into it, but I never ever set out to be famous, no.
What has fame given you? What has it taken away from you?
Well, let's go first to what it's taken away. The only thing it's really taken away is my privacy, the ability to blend in. There are moments when I can do this and I love that because momentarily I forget that a lot of people know who I am, and are focusing on me, which I love because I love to be an observer of people. And I've had to learn because of my fame sometimes not to look directly in people's eyes as I'm walking down the streets, just to give myself and my family a little more privacy. So that's the only thing it's really taken away. What it's given me is an opportunity to change things, to affect people's lives through my music, my lyrics, in a positive way, which to me is very important. To live my life in a very beautiful part of life, which is music, and to somehow be able to become a part of people's lives even without meeting them, and to live in a life that's creative, that you are making something that wasn't there before and people like it and accept it, and it's a beautiful thing.
Are you fortunate? Are you lucky?
I'm very fortunate. I consider myself a very fortunate person just because I think success is doing what you love a lot of the times of the day, a lot of hours in the day, being able to have relationships that are good and solid and loving, and being able to enjoy life. And to me, I do all those three things.
Why do you sing?
I sing because it came with me. It's a need, like breathing. And I didn't have to do it for someone else. When I was young, my father was very ill, and we went through some very difficult things, and I would lock myself up in my room by myself with my guitar and sing. And while I would sing, the tears would fall and the emotions would come out, and it was a way for me to let out many things that I felt I had to be very strong so that my mother wouldn't suffer so much, knowing that I was going through a tough time. I wanted to be strong for her. So music allowed me a catharsis, a way to express.
How do you describe your voice, Gloria Estefan? Do you think you have an outstanding voice?
I think I'm a communicator, and I think that what people may like about my voice is the honesty that it brings. I don't think I'm technically one of the best singers you've ever heard. Mm-hmm. I can sing very well in pitch. I have a good ear for that, but my voice to me is a way to transmit feelings, emotions, and thoughts, and it was, since I began singing, an escape for me, and I think that people capture that, and I think perhaps that's what they like in it.
Why does your voice penetrate millions of people all over the world?
Hopefully it's because they realize that what is behind the voice is honesty, and the things that I'm singing about are either meant to make them think a little bit or maybe make them be able to communicate to someone that they love or have feelings for with through my songs, some feelings that they might have, or maybe just to have fun, that, you know, for a few moments or 2 hours in the show that I give, they forget about their problems at home, and they're just a part of something that is fun and musical, and they can just, I entertain them, which is what we do. Mm. We're an entertainer, get them to forget their problems.
When does an artist inspire people?
I think when they believe you, you inspire them. I think when they know you've been through some things and that the messages that you're sending come from a real life experience, that they know that you've lived the situation, perhaps, and you inspire them to stay in a situation. For example, after my accident, I broke my back 16 years ago, and songs like Get On Your Feet and Coming Out of the Dark and Always Tomorrow came from a lot of pain and getting past it. And I think if people know about these things, they believe you a little better.
Where do you attempt, or where do you tend to take your fans to?
I like to think that if they're coming to a live show to listen to me, that I'm going to take them somewhere that they haven't been. First of all, if they're going to listen to music they like, I want them to take a piece of me with them and understand that it's not just listening to a record, that there's some kind of exchange of energy, communication, something like that. If they're going to listen to my record at home, I'm very careful when we mix the album and when we do the arrangements and when we do, you know, when I sing the song, that I take them on a journey, an emotional journey, and make them feel something. That's all I ever want, to try to make them feel something.
Millions of fans all over the world, millions of dollars made out of all those journeys, all those concerts. Have you been spoiled by success?
I don't think so. To me, success, I feel very fortunate to have had. I love people. I never think myself above anyone. I feel that I live a very fortunate life in being able to, like I said, live in a very beautiful part of life, which is music. And I had an early life that was so tough that I think it gave me a lot of strong, strong roots and foundation for the life that I was going to have after. So I don't think I'm spoiled at all.
جلورا ستيفان بعت أكثر من 100 مليون أسطوانة هي ضيفة هذه الحلقة من وراء الوجوه استراحة مع الإعلان نعود من بعد لمتابعة هذا الحوار خليكم معنا
kept me from being with you. I cradle your faith that reveals me, grows like a flower, then heals me, fills me with promise anew. I carry your warm disillusion when my pathetic confusion kept me from speaking the truth. Simply a coin in your fountain, lost like the seconds I'm counting till I am closer to you. I cherish every morning that found us, with the night scattered around us, faded and painted me blue. I carry your joy in my footsteps, making my way to your harbor. Don't need to go any farther, you are my sun and my moon, wrapped in your arms where it's peaceful, back in your arms where I'm happy.
نعود لمتابعة هذا الحوار المشوق مع المغنية العالمية ملكة البوب اللاتيني جلوريا ستيفان. جلوريا, you have met Emilio 27 years ago at church. A flashback to that scene, how could you eventually reset the scene that witnessed that encounter?
Okay, well, actually, we've been married 27 years, so when I met him was almost 30 years ago. In May, it will be 30 years that I met Emilio Stefan. And he saw me at church, but I did not see him. Then a friend of mine that we were playing guitar together called Emilio to come to his house to give us some ideas to put a band together. We were doing it for one night for a religious thing for our parents. They used to call it encounter groups. And we were going to do a celebration, play that one night, and it was going to be over. So Emilio came to his house in some shorts and his accordion. And he listened to us play and we listened to him play. And I remember being very impressed with his hands. For me, hands are very important in a human being and they fascinate me to look.
What do they represent for you?
To me, I can tell if the person is a hard worker. I think that hands very much express the personality of the person that is, and the way they move their hands and the things they do with their hands. So of course he's playing the accordion, my eyes are focusing on his hands. And I thought, what a nice young man, and he left and that was it. And then several months later, my mother asked me to go accompany her to a wedding of a friend of ours. And when I walked into the room, his band was playing. And he was playing a song called Do the Hustle on the accordion. This was one of the disco tunes back in the 70s. And I thought, how brave he is to play Do the Hustle on the accordion. And the band was having such a wonderful time and everyone was having a great time. And I thought, they have ángel in Spanish, which means charisma. They have something special. So then we were in a doorway. I was going to cross. He was going to cross. He says, oh, aren't you that girl that sang in that band that night? I go, yes, yes, I am. He goes, why don't you sing some songs with the band? Your sit-in, they call it. And of course, my mother, who was listening, oh, yeah, sing, sing, because these were people I would play my guitar for when I was a little child. And I said, well, what do you know that I know? And we sang two old Cuban standards, Sabor a Mí and Tú Me Acostumbraste. These are very, very old Cuban songs. And of course, I got a standing ovation because everybody knew me at the wedding. And he was very impressed. And he said, I don't have a singer in the band. Would you like to join? I said, I can't. I'm starting the university. I have a job already full time. I can't do it. And 2 weeks later, he tracked me down. And he said, look, this is just a hobby for fun. We rehearse two nights a week. We work on the weekends. You don't have to stop school or work. And I said, well, I don't know. He said, bring your mother and your grandmother, because he knew that it was very family oriented. So you could see he lived with his parents in a small apartment. And when the band would rehearse, the whole apartment building would have a party because they had no choice. So I went and I thought, you know, I think this would be a lot of fun for me. And I told my mother I'd really like to do this. And
can we talk about In Love From First Sight?
Well, you know, I don't really believe in love at first sight. I believe that there can be an attraction. And I believe you can recognize maybe someone's soul. I do think that you can somehow maybe feel that you know this person from somewhere, or there's some kind of connection. I think that there can be that feeling, but love...
When you're 17, 18?
Well, I don't think
nowadays
that it's something...
Maybe, or today maybe.
Well, I just think that there may be some kind of recognition that can either grow into something or not. I wouldn't recommend to everyone to go on their first feeling. I think that love, at least the love that is going to entail a marriage, needs to be based on something stronger than that. And Emilio and I, we dated for 2 years. We never talked about marriage.
When love comes, it comes.
Yes, but he was very afraid. He started dating me a year after when I had been working for him for a year. And he was very afraid that something, if we got into a personal relationship, that it might, if something went wrong, it would mess up the professional one, which was going very well. So.
You're the world's best-known Latin pop star, and your husband, Emilio, happens to be the world's best-known Latin producer, music producer. You think it's a good idea for a couple to collaborate, cooperate, and work together?
For us, it's been great. For everyone, it depends on your personality. It's a tough thing because there could be no egos. He doesn't have a problem with ego, neither do I. We fell in love before any of this happened, so we really fell in love with each other, not an image. Because sometimes what happens is when you meet someone that's already famous, you have a certain idea in your head of who they are, and you don't give them an opportunity to be who they really are. And the person never really trusts that if you fell in love with them or who they think you are. So it's a tough situation. And also you have to have a very deep sense of balance as to where does the manager start or the producer start and the husband begin and vice versa. There's moments where you really have to learn very carefully how to tell someone what you think professionally when they're your lover, your wife, your husband. And yes, it's a difficult thing to achieve, but we've been very lucky. I think our personalities worked very well for that.
Talking about image, the image you reflect is a solid one. We see you as a solid couple. Actually, is it as solid as that image reflected?
Yes, it is. It's not perfect, but solid.
Nothing is perfect, actually.
Yes, exactly.
Is it possible to maintain a strong partnership as well as a strong romantic partnership?
Yes, it's possible. Like I said, it takes a lot of understanding. It takes sometimes one partner carrying the load, other times another partner carrying the load. It takes commitment, a lot of communication, and feeling that you are going to get through whatever difficulties, and always trying that first before the first option being, I'm out of here, because that nowadays I think it tends to happen more. If you don't make me happy, I'm gone. And when you have two people, you really have to think of yourselves as two people, and that's hard to do, but yes, it's possible.
Having your songs as number ones, as big hits on the different charts worldwide, is a dream of every artist. Being number one in your family and with your family is also a dream, which is very important. How do you describe your family life?
My family comes first. in every instance. I've been fortunate that being a woman, I could bring my children to work with me. And then my husband has been extremely wonderful in helping me achieve that, because it really takes a partnership. But they are number one, and I think that the only way that you can do that is really making those kinds of sacrifices. Many times I've made decisions based on what's good for my family and not my career. And those are tough things to do, but to me, what's more important is the family. The career will come, will go, but the family is there forever.
Nowadays, you're investing most of your time on your little Emily.
Yes.
She's 10 years now.
Yes.
I've seen her, and I knew that you're so close to her, and most of your time, you take care personally of her. You take her to school, you bring her from school, and I was told that your eldest one, Najib, who's now
yes,
24 years old, I won't say you neglected him, but you were not always available for him.
Yes.
Your behavior today with your daughter, is it to make it up for what happened
with
your
son? That's
a good
question. But you know what, actually, with Najib, in his first 5 years, we still were not with the fame that we have now. We were doing things in Miami, and I gave him the same exact thing. I took him every day to, you know, preschool and back. When he got older, only 1 year I spent away from Najib because he did not want to go on tour with me. So that's when Emilio stopped performing in the band and he stayed with him. And after that year was over, I said to Emilio, either we all go together or I don't go. Because I suffered so much in moments where I would plan, for example, his first communion to be there. And 2 weeks before the first communion, they changed the date because of something that happened in the school. And I could not change the date because I had made a commitment and we would be in big, big trouble if suddenly I had canceled. So I missed out on things with him in that 1 year. And I said, I'm not going to make this a lifetime. And I said to him, we all go or we don't. So Najib actually did go with me everywhere else. And I spent as much time with him as I have spent with Emily. I've tried to give both my kids the same thing. They're two different people. Najib did not like school. He has ADD like his father. And he loved being on the road with a tutor so he could get his schoolwork done in 2 hours and not be sitting 8 hours in a school. Emily loves school. So the reason that I am spending more time with her and doing things that she likes is because she likes that. Najib loved being on the road with me. So it's a balance. But yes, you learn a lot as a parent. And I also have a lot more luxury to choose what I want to do when I want to do it right now, and I'll take advantage of that.
You call him Najib. We call him Najib.
Najib, Najib. I've called him both things.
You know what does that mean?
Someone told me that it meant good person or
true.
Good man. That's what we hoped for him.
Is he good?
He's a good boy. He's, well, he's a man now. He's 25, actually. And but he is very mischievous and plays a lot of jokes and tricks like his father. And he's very creative.
Very Lebanese.
Yeah. Yes, he is. He looks very Lebanese, too. He looks very much.
Gloria Estefan, ملكة البوب اللاتيني, هي ضيفتنا الليلة. منتابع حوارنا معها بعد هذه الاستراحة. خليكم معنا أصدقائي المشاهدين.
Father, on behalf of my family, I would like to congratulate you on your 50 years of service in the priesthood of Jesus Christ. We thank you for all the work you've done worldwide for the betterment of human rights and ask you to pray for peace on earth. Oh,
نعود لمتابعة هذا الحوار مع غلوريا إستيفان ملكة البوب اللاتيني مباشرة من ميامي. غلوريا ماريا فاردو, you were born in Havana, Cuba,
yes.
in 1957.
Yes.
Your family, supporter of former President Batista, had to move and fly to the States. You were over 1 year old, almost 2 years, running away from the new regime of Fidel Castro. Today, almost 50 years after, do you consider Cuba to be your home?
What a good question. I consider Miami to be my home, but I have an incredible magnetic pull from Cuba for some reason. I think that perhaps somehow we choose the place we're going to be born, and I feel that there is something pending with me, with Cuba. Perhaps it's because Cubans raise their children so much in love with Cuba, and my mother, of course, the Cuba that she knew, because I know very much right now that the Cuba that is there now is a different world, is a different country. But I certainly can't say that I'm American. I can't say that I'm completely Cuban. I'm Cuban-American, but even more than that, I'm Miamian, because Miami is one of the few places that affords me the luxury of being so immersed in my culture and still being in this, you know, country, the United States that opened their arms to us and all these immigrants that have come here. And it's also a very, very unique city. It's got its own foreign policy, separate from the United States, I think in part due to the Cubans. And it really is a place like no other. So I do very much feel like I'm a part of this city. I was raised here. Emilio and I have contributed very much to the growth of the city in different ways, both in business and in image because of our music. So I do feel very much, probably what my mother felt towards Cuba, I feel towards Miami, but I still have something pulling me.
Moreover, being who you are, I think you would be citizen of the world.
Yes, most definitely. And my son especially feels like a citizen of the world because he was everywhere and he's lived in London and he felt just as comfortable there. But I love it here.
Actually, being American and Cuban, how do you carry this heritage, this bicultural heritage?
Yes.
And how could you perpetuate it in your music?
I say that I have an American head and a Cuban heart because all my schooling was done here. We do business very much the American way. We're very organized. We are very careful to do everything by the letter of the law. But in our hearts is the love of extended family. You know, Cuban family is not just mother, father, brother and sister, like in the United States. It's grandparents and uncles and aunts and cousins and everybody, and even people that aren't part of your bloodline but have grown up with you as family. Food, very important. Music, we'll dance anywhere. I've danced with my housekeeper in the kitchen just because some good song comes on the radio. I've danced with my dogs, you know. Music is a very big part. And how do I continue it? If you ask both my children, they'll tell you they're Cuban-American, even though they're really Americans. Mm. They were born here, and they take that in their hearts. Mm.
Cubans are more human.
Well, I don't know if more human, but we certainly love to laugh. I think the only reason that Cubans have survived so long with the dilemma they live in Cuba is because of sense of humor. Mm. We can laugh at a lot of things, including ourselves, and very hardworking. Mm. I think everywhere I've been in the world, I find a Cuban, mm. even in Morocco, where the guy that rented me a camel was Cuban. I'm going, what are you doing here? He rents me a camel and he's a Cuban in Morocco. So we're all spread out all over, and we can feel comfortable anywhere. I don't know why, but definitely part of the Cuban way.
You created the Gloria Estefan Foundation.
Yes.
Several years ago. Did it add any change to your life?
The Gloria Estefan Foundation is a dream that I've had since I was a little girl, to try to help as much as I could, my community, people that needed help. And this career has afforded me that opportunity. I am able to do many things, and a lot of things, most of the things we do, I don't talk about or I'm not public with, because I don't feel I need that. Some of the things you need to be public with because you need the help of other people, like the research that we're doing with the Miami Project in spinal cord research. We're about to announce, or actually announcing a $1 million donation to the Miami Project to go into human trials. They're very close to the cure for paralysis. And being a very lucky person, because according to the doctors, I should be in a wheelchair and not walking, I think that it is very important for me to somehow help as much as I can to get that cure possible for many people that have gone through this to have. So that and many other things, anything having to do with children, with education, we try to help people that can't find help from other foundations, people that need, we've helped people get operations that they've needed. We've helped in a lot of natural disasters that have happened in different parts of the world. So just, I love to help in whatever way I can, and that has made that possible for me.
Gloria, you have dreamt of touching the lives of people in need, in a real and in a positive way. You believe in giving back to the community that has given you so much. What are the most precious thing people gave you?
Love. Love without knowing me. I walk down the street and someone will say, I just want you to give me a hug. And they'll squeeze me and tell me how I've made them, you know, help them through a tough time. Or in small ways, some people that'll say, because of you, you know, and your song, I went back with my husband or wife because I was able to, you know, through your music, work it out with them. Or to the extreme of someone that says that I was going to take my own life and your song came on the radio, Coming Out of the Dark, or Always Tomorrow, and I, those lyrics hit me deeply and I stopped.
Consequently, how does this love feed you?
Oh my gosh, feeling people's love is one of the most beautiful things. I think our prime motivation in life is to be loved and to give love and maybe learn how to love unconditionally. So it's a very powerful thing. I think it helped me become healthy. I can tell you, when I was in my accident, I could feel physically like an energy around me. People's prayers, didn't matter what religion they were from, and people's good thoughts and wishes and the love they were giving me, I could feel that, and I channeled it into my body and I used it through meditation. I sent it right to my spine where things needed to reconnect. I absorbed it. They didn't let me feel down or depressed for one moment. My family, they thought I was crazy, that I wasn't facing reality and that I was going to be facing a very hard truth, and I kept telling them, I'm going to be okay. And that was very much due to the love that I felt from everyone and their prayers, which I think is a very powerful force.
What is today the long-term goal you're thriving for?
I want to be remembered with love. I wrote a song called that, Remember Me With Love. I think that in order to continue the chain, inspire my children to also feel the responsibility to help their fellow man and in whatever way they can, because they're in a privileged situation where they can be of help to other people. And I want them to feel that and to take action with that. I would love for people, maybe when they look at what I've been through, to think, I can do this. I can change my life to be the way that I want it to be. I can have everything I want. I can have a successful family, do what I love, help other people. It's possible. I can take control of my body. If I'm going through a tough time, I have the power to focus my energy on changing those things that I want to be different. And I would hope that I would be an example of that and make them feel that it's possible.
تسعى إلى التغيير, تحاول مساعدة الآخرين, تعطي محبة للآخرين, تسعى إلى مساعدة ضحايا الكوارث الطبيعية وإلى مساعدة القضايا الإنسانية الكبيرة. هي جلورا إستيفان ضيفة هذه الحلقة من وراء الوجوه. نعود لمتابعة القسم الأخير من لقائنا وحوارنا بعد هذه الاستراحة الأخيرة. خليكم معنا.
That's the theme of the night.
القسم الرابع والأخير من لقائنا مع المغنية العالمية ملكة البوب اللاتيني جلوريا إستيفان. جلوريا, you have written worldwide hits recorded by many renowned artists such as Shakira and Jennifer Lopez. Is it easy to write lyrics, to compose for other singers who compete with you?
Yes, it is, because they're also working for me. They would be competing with me anyway, so it's nice that they're also making money for me.
But there's the ego also, which no. is predominant somewhere.
But you know what, I don't have that kind of ego. Both Shakira and Jennifer, first of all, are Hispanic, so I'm very proud to somehow have opened the door a little bit, just like before me, Feliciano, Santana, Desi Arnaz, way back, opened the door for me. And I feel very proud that we had a little bit of something to do with Shakira's success, and we believed in her, and I was the one that talked her into writing in English and said, you could do this, and that she grew to the incredible, monstrous success that she's had worldwide. Because not only is she Colombian, she's also Lebanese. True. And to me, it was like helping a daughter, you know, step up. She's a very talented person. I really admire her as an artist. So it was wonderful to somehow be involved in helping her in that way and helping her feel that she could do it. And Jennifer as well, even though Jennifer really grew up in New York, she doesn't speak too much Spanish. But when I wrote that song and I was going to record it on my album, it really didn't fit my album, I thought, and she loved it. So I go, great, go Jennifer. And every time I hear that song, I get very happy because I go, wow, well, even with them, I'm still there somehow in a little way. So it's a good thing.
Now in February, you'll be releasing a new CD, yes. which will be enclosing new songs in Spanish. Where could you perceive your soul and your spirit more? Is it in the Spanish songs or the English ones?
That's Which also lyrics a very good question.
Do carry more your soul?
I think if I had to choose only one thing to do from here to the when I'm out of here of this life, it would have to be Spanish. Oh. Because not only was it my first language, but when I'm singing a song like Mi Tierra or Con los años que me quedan, it is more me probably. Mm. Well, you know what it's like? Once again, I told you I have, my head is American, my heart is Cuban, although my head is a big part of who I am because I'm constantly thinking. Unwrapped, the last album I did, would probably represent me in the English side. But if I had to choose only one, it would be the Spanish, because that's where my heart lies. And I think art is much more in the heart than in the head, most definitely.
You will be acting soon in a movie where you will be portraying the life of the 40s famous pop star, Connie Francis.
Yes.
It's your first leading role. Are you ready?
I'm ready for the experience, and I feel I'm ready because I've spent 4 years working with Connie Francis, and that's the kind of experience that very rarely does any actor get. So I admire her so much, and I think she's done so many incredible things, and there's so many messages that I hope to portray in that movie for women and for, you know, people in general that I'm looking very much forward. Will it be a challenge? Yes. Mm. She had some very difficult moments in her life. I know there's moments in my life that I can draw upon to portray hers, but yes, it will be a big challenge, and I will prepare as I've been preparing. I've been taking acting lessons for many years, and it's not that I'm just going to throw myself out there. I will prepare very, very, very well for that, besides the 4 years that I've spent with Connie.
The magically mysterious adventures of Noel the Bulldog.
Yes.
A story for kids published last October 2005. Noel, with his Christmassy name, is the hero of that story. It's a dog. It appeared with you on TV with Oprah.
Yes.
And it also appeared
on The View. What
was the moral behind the story?
First, I don't think that people know how much I love animals. My friends call me Doolittle One, like Dr. Doolittle, and because I'm little too. I have a very, very strong connection with animals. And I have 9 dogs, one of which is Noel. Noel, I identify with because Noel is from Colombia, South America. I bought her for my son as a gift for Christmas. But she came and she was sick the next day so badly that the veterinarian told me she's going to die. Get your son another present. I bought him another present and I said, you have to try to save her because we made a connection. So Noelle survived. She came to my house. It was only 5 Dalmatians and her. And she was trying so hard to fit in and to be a Dalmatian. She would try to run faster and stay up with them. And, you know, bulldogs are very chunky, short dogs. And she reminded me of me and when I came to this country trying to fit in, trying to be American, trying to learn the language and feeling strange. And I thought this would be a great angle to somehow inspire children. I studied psychology in the university and I was going to major in, my specialty would be child psychology. So it's a wonderful opportunity to combine everything I love, writing, because it's done in verse like a long song, animals, which I love, and inspiring children, maybe putting some very positive thoughts in their head through this fun story that it's important to be who you are, that being different is not bad, that your weaknesses can become your strengths. And it's a nice way for me to now start in a very early level with young children to somehow make them, empower them or make them feel positive.
Today, you are who you are and you are what you are. Still, do you have more dreams?
Of course, I dream to enjoy my family, to spend more and more time with the people I love. I hope to grow more as a writer. I'd love to do not just children's books, but I would love to write books for adults as well. And contribute, be of service. I think that's what I'm here to be on the earth, be of service to others in whatever way I can, for as long as I can, and that I'm healthy and able to do it. That's what I'm going to do. I live one day at a time. Ever since I almost died at 32 in that accident, I realized that all you can ever do is live one day at a time because you never know how long you're going to be here or when it's going to be over. So to try to make each day the best it can be, and that's the only way that I live now. I try to make each day the best it can be and try to enjoy the most I can while being of service, which is what I love and makes me happy.
Your father was exiled. He ended up in jail after a failing coup d'etat against Castro. He was sent to Vietnam. You saw him sick. You saw him moving to a hospital. You saw him dying. You had a severe back injury. You almost passed away. Did the music help you in feeling better the world around you? Is it a healer?
Music can change the way I feel in 1 second. Whether it's music that was a part of my childhood that takes me back and makes me feel deeply or relive a moment. Yes, music got me through some very tough times. As I told you, when my father was very ill, it was my way of letting out my feelings alone in my room so that my mother wouldn't see the difficulty I was going through because I felt I had to be strong for her. During my accident, right afterwards, I had been in my house for 3 months doing 5 to 6 hours a day in rehab and thinking that I might never get my performing life back. And Emilio, in his very wise way and very subtly, came to me with a little piece of paper, and written on the paper was the words, "Coming out of the dark." And he said to me, the day we were transported in the helicopters to New York after my accident for my operation, he was in one helicopter, I was in another. And it was a very gray, dark day. But wherever he would go in his helicopter, there was one ray of light that kept shining on his face. And he says that all he was doing was praying, God, please let this darkness be over as soon as it can be. So he wrote down that phrase on a piece of paper, he put it in his pants. Months later, he finds it again, all washed, you know, and wet from the laundry. And he says to me, I think that it's time that you you may not be able to sing or perform, but you can write. And I think you need to express some things. And he showed me this piece of paper. And he says, why don't you come to the studio? John Secada is there, and we have an idea to do this song. And I said, oh, you know what, I'll go. And we went, and John sang me the melody just with those words. And in 20 minutes, we wrote that song. And that made me feel like I could be useful again, regardless of what happened with my body. So once again, music was a very healing thing for me. And from that moment on, I started focusing not just on my physical recuperation, but also on my mental and my emotional recuperation, and realizing that I could still be, regardless of what happened, I could still do my thing and communicate. And once again, music proved to be very, very healing for me.
Today, 16 years after, I still feel the effect and the impact of that accident through your eyes.
Yes, indeed. But you know what? I would not change it. I think it was a beautiful thing. It was meant to be, I am sure. The outcome has been great. I have some hardware in there, but that I don't beep in the airports. It's titanium. People always ask me, do you beep when you go through the airport? No, I don't beep. But I think that perhaps that was my purpose. And I know that I've had much more of an impact in people's lives than if I just would have been a successful pop star. I think the fact that they felt that pain with me, my fans, it was at a moment in my career, I was at the top of my game and very, very well known. And I think that everyone really lived that experience with me. And to see me get past it, I think, was an important thing for my fans. And hopefully inspired them in some way in their own life to keep moving on and growing and never giving up.
Emilio is originally from Lebanon,
yes.
Betroun precisely. Your kids have Lebanese roots.
Yes, they do.
Do you consider dropping by and paying tribute to their ancestors?
Of course, and that is one place that we have, that is high on our list to visit. This year is the first time that we are going to be able to visit a place where I am not working, that I am going on vacation when I go to Egypt. And we are definitely adding Lebanon to the list of where we will go very soon in our travels, where I can really enjoy and not have to worry about taking care of my voice and, you know, and being so good. But it's funny because a lot of people think I'm the Lebanese one. The people, I go, I've been with Emilio so long, we look alike already. I know that it could be because of my Asturiana roots.
Your features,
yes,
are Middle Eastern.
Yes, I know. Mm. I think because, you know, there was a lot of Middle Eastern mix in northern Spain. Mm. And my grandfather on my mother's side was from northern Spain, from Asturias. So you never know. Back in the family, I can only go back two generations. I don't know what happened before then.
So. You might have fooled around.
Well, or somebody in the family might have been. Might have been that I don't know about. I don't know, but...
Gloria, you were once offered $6 million to play in a private party in the Middle East. You refused that offer. I'd like to know at the end of this interview, which country was that country that offered you to go and perform over there, and why did you refuse that offer? It was a huge one.
That was a big one. I think it was Dubai, if I remember correctly. I can't remember why at the moment I would turn down $6 million. I would tell him to call me back. I don't know why at that moment. There must have been something very, very important that I would have missed by going to perform. But they can call me now. I got a lot of free time right now.
Inshallah. Gloria Estefan, it was more than a pleasure to host you and to conduct this interview with you.
Thank you for including me in your show. I know that you've interviewed probably most important people in the world, and it's an honor that you asked me to be on your show. I really appreciate it, and I will definitely be visiting you over there, so then maybe you can show me your town and your country.
We're looking forward to it, and we're looking forward to having you in a concert in the Arab world.
I would love that, definitely. I would love to say that even though I'm married to my Lebanese husband and has given me a whole other way of looking at the world, which I love and feel very comfortable with. I still have pending visiting his homeland, which is Lebanon, and wherever I go in the world, I run into many Middle Eastern people, and they tell me how much they love my music, and I tell them that I will be there in concert because that is somewhere I've never been, and I'm definitely looking forward to that.
Inshallah.
Thank you very much.
Can you add a word in Arabic?
I must say the first thing Emilio taught me, which is, I don't know if that's a good thing, was Habibi Atini Bausa.
Give me a kiss.
Yes. Of course, I didn't know what he was saying at the time, but I learned quickly.
أصدقائي المشاهدين بتمنى تكونوا استمتعتوا بهذا الحوار الممتع والشيق مع المغنية العالمية وملكة البوب اللاتيني جلورا إستيفان. نهاية سهرة ممتعة وبتمنى لكم عيد فصح مجيد. تصبحوا على خير.